The PS5 launch day is like 2 days away, and for the fortunate people who secured a pre-order, or the morally skewed bot users making $500 off some anxiety-ridden, hype-crazed fan, it's a very big day. The release has obviously been plagued by issues and will continue being criticized probably for all of eternity. But before you lose your minds, there's some good news. There's still one more chance to secure an online order from either Target or Walmart and pick up your console on the release date. This means that your path to victory could still have the fairy tale ending you've been dreaming of. My advice to you is to be sharp and keep an eye on Twitter over the next couple days and have that finger on the pulse when the time comes. Otherwise, you could end up being one of those hype-crazed fiends, stricken with panic, down on your knees, a shell of the person you once were, begging somebody to pay them upwards of $1,000 for a $499 console, which there's no shame in, but can be avoided, at least for now. There are a lot of incredible games coming with the release. We have Godfall, the Warframe-inspired melee loot-driven game where you collect various Valor plates, which are nothing like the Warframes in Warframe, but function the exact same way. Then we have Spider-Man, Miles Morales, which is said to be inspired and similar to the Uncharted series, so we'll see how that plays out. So far it's looking really good, but Spider-Man games have always triggered a dark emotional reaction when I think about the Game Awards when everyone thought From Software was going to announce a new game, and it ended up being the 2018 version of Spider-Man. Maybe this game can finally break the curse. Then we have Sackboy, A Big Adventure. While the title may have you thinking otherwise, this is a cute, family-friendly game based off the character Sackboy from Little Big Planet. He's a hacky sack and not the other type of sack that you were likely thinking of. Other than these first two games and Sackboy, there are mostly just updated next-gen versions of games like Borderlands 3 and Assassin's Creed Valhalla, which both look really nice, but obviously are not as hyped as they're already available. So what should you guys buy first when you get your brand new console? Well, there's one game I purposefully didn't mention on this list so I could mention it at the end because it's clearly the best choice, and that is the Demon's Souls remake by Bluepoint Games. Look guys, it's no secret that I'm slightly biased. If you've watched my channel at all, you'll see that I make a lot of videos on From Software games. This is because in my opinion, and just factually, they're some of the best games ever created. Many of you have probably played a Dark Souls game or Bloodborne or Sekiro, but From Software really grew to popularity with the Dark Souls series, and so many people never took the time to go back and play the game that started it all. And the release of this remake will likely be many people's first playthrough, which will be a transformative and magical experience that will restore your inner self that you lost from paying $1,000 for a $499 console. As a PC user primarily, it's hard sometimes to define what the fuck next gen really is. Often next gen is the current gen, or even past gens, of the current PC gen. And the PC next gen is like three gens, possibly more gens ahead sometimes, of the newest console gen. This is the first game that was showcased that in my opinion truly represents what a next gen game actually is. And even on a ridiculously, stupidly, absurdly, unnecessarily powerful PC, the visuals in this game would be considered to be very good. For fans of the series, this is a no-brainer, and for many people, they shy away from Souls games because they find them too difficult and rage-inducing. So should you shy away from Demon's Souls for this reason? You've probably heard that it's the most difficult Souls game, because this is commonly said in the community and all over Reddit. In my opinion, it's the most accessible Souls game. While the levels are often more difficult, the boss mechanics are mostly easier and more simplified, and the game has a much stronger narrative than the more vague Dark Souls games, which give players a better sense of what the fuck is going on without having to study very subtle cues and read the theories and pages of lore constructed from shreds of info and items provided in-game. Let me put it this way, the monumental cutscene in Demon's Souls that lays out the archstones and general objectives of the game has more dialogue and explanation than all three Souls games combined in a 3.5 minute video. This may be an exaggeration, but in Demon's Souls there is a clear objective and you actually know why you're doing everything you're doing from the very start. There are some key differences though that make Demon's Souls a unique experience. Even if you're a Dark Souls, Sekiro, and Bloodborne veteran, the level design that was adopted in Dark Souls and carried through through every From Software game since is absent in Demon's Souls. It's very non-linear. The worlds are not connected. The first time you die, you'll wake up in a hub area called the Nexus, and while some things remain the same, like the Maiden in Black in Demon's Souls, which is the same thing as the Firekeeper in Dark Souls and the doll from Bloodborne, but you have a choice of which of the five worlds you wish to progress through, with each one containing 3 to 4 sub-levels with its own boss. There's quite a lot more freedom in which order to tackle the bosses in, and not a specific laid out path to reach endgame. It's almost like the early Legend of Zelda games for Game Boy. You have choice, and absolute shitloads of it. The combat system's gonna feel quite similar to all the rest of the Souls games you've played or haven't played, and all of the other games that have copied it, which is great because it's really fucking good and ridiculously satisfying, and once practiced, it isn't as difficult as it seems initially. It's always fair, regardless of that first jolt of rage when you die after not having reached a checkpoint. Speaking about checkpoints, they're laid out very differently in Demon's Souls. There's an absence of bonfires, but you will save progress every time you defeat a boss in a sub-area of a world, which then enables you to port there upon death from the Nexus. There are also hidden shortcuts, like in the Souls series, so you aren't forced to run across the entire map to get back to where you were because you took a sip of your energy drink because your eyes are bleeding after playing for 13 hours straight and you got one-shotted. The way the builds function in Demon's Souls is really similar if you've played Dark Souls games. There's a myriad of weapons, most of which scale with specific stats so you're able to craft a build for your character around a weapon that you enjoy using. I was reading a forum post the other day that claimed that Demon's Souls is way more balanced than the Dark Souls games, with far less options to exploit overpowered builds. I'm here to tell you that that is complete bullshit, and whoever wrote that article is a goddamn fool. There are massively overpowered weapons in this game, such as the halberd, that if used with certain stats, can turn a difficult game into a relatively uncomfortable, but very reasonably tolerable walk in the park. There are magic and faith-based builds that can yield insane damage output and even unlimited regenerating health. The possibilities are absolutely endless, but since this is a remake, most of these powered items and builds have already long been discovered and researched for your use. Estus flasks or something similar have been the main healing method in every From Software game since Dark Souls 1, but you will not be finding them in Demon's Souls. Instead, you'll be finding Darkmoon grass items of various potency to mend your character, and the difference is, these items do not conveniently refresh at checkpoints like Estus flasks. They can be purchased and carried in much larger numbers, which if you spent time farming can make the game quite a lot easier, as you'd have way more charges than the max amount of Estus flasks you can carry in Dark Souls, but overall the system limits your healing in my opinion more than the cap of Estus flasks, because you have to actually do something to get more of these items, and they cost a lot of souls, so this'll take you some time. They can also be found throughout the world in very decent numbers, and you can farm them as drops while also farming souls to buy more. It's not incredible. Punishing. It's just not as easy as the old auto refill you've become accustomed to. The last thing I wanted to touch on is the concern that a lot of people have that the deluxe edition items are making the game pay to win because you start off the game really overpowered. This deluxe edition has garnered complaints and caused controversy since the second it was announced, and at $90 a pop, you'd have to be an absolute fool and completely lack a logical decision-making process to think these items are worth the additional fee. With that being said, I have already pre-ordered the deluxe edition version for myself. It just pains me way too much to lose out on unique appearances, three of which will not be available in the base game, including the Red Eye Knight armor, the Boletarian Royalty armor, and the Ritual Blade. All of these look so fucking cool. I just can't not have them personally, but is this game pay to win? Absolutely not. Yes, you can get these items early for paying, and it may make the game slightly easier at the beginning, but overall, there are plenty of ridiculously absurd weapons that will probably outweigh the power of the Ritual Blade and the Reaper Scythe within hours of gameplay. I think more importantly than the armor sets and the weapons themselves, the various soul-granting items you receive are the most overpowered thing about this bundle, though not enough to actually make a difference in the grand scope of the game. Let me put it this way, it's not like the deluxe edition will make you an unstoppable, unkillable, one-shotting machine that can zero damage the game first try. It's more for convenience, though even still, I wish it wasn't in the game because it makes you feel like you're missing out if you don't spend the extra money, and you absolutely are. Regardless though, Demon's Souls is a beloved classic, and for good reason. Bluepoint Games have an excellent reputation, and from what we've seen, the game has absolutely blown our dicks off beyond what we ever could have dreamt of, and for those reasons, it's by far far the best choice to purchase before anything else, maybe aside from Sackboy, when you first get your PS5. They launched this game with the PS5 for a reason. It's an exclusive because people who know the Souls series well know it's worth buying a console just to play one Souls game. I personally bought a PS4 just to play Bloodborne when it launched, and I never really played anything else on it. And even if Demon's Souls is the only game you ever play on your PS5, which it probably won't be, and even to pay $450 just to play this game, or even $1,000 if you got your PS5 from some butthole online, it would still be worth it in my opinion. Do yourself a favor, and even if you aren't a Souls fan, give this game a chance and buy it first. You won't regret it. Love is something that requires work, and it's not always the easiest option, but once you put in the time and create that love and committed relationship with the Souls series, there's nothing else that compares. If you enjoyed this video, please drop a like and subscribe to my channel for more Souls content. I will be making Demon's Souls content starting on launch day, so stay tuned for that. As always, I appreciate you all. Thank you so much for watching, and stay safe, my bros.